to let yourself be the voice of God.
Yeah.
It's always very disappointing. It's really disheartening. It really wears you down. It's exhausting. But on the other hand, at least we're talking about it. I mean, we're talking about it, and that is an exciting new, that is a very exciting new development. Like, to be able to be very, to have a robust conversation about it, like, to be able to just say it out loud feels so fresh.
And when people ask you, what do you think is the future, like, where do we go from here?
Yeah.
Do you feel like you have a real answer for that?
I don't have an answer for that. That's, anyway, end of show. Good night. I don't have an answer for that. I think that, you know, to have the conversation is very important, obviously essential. You know, what ends up happening is that these, you know, it really does have a ripple effect. Like, I definitely know a bunch of journalists who, you know, were part of revealing people's inner workings. And the reality is that hundreds and hundreds of women reach out to these journalists, like, after the fact, and they're like, because of your story, I'm going to tell you this story. So the outpouring of people's stories is, like, it is momentous, and it does feel different, but it's, there's a lot. Mm-hmm. There's so much pain out there, and there's so much trauma out there. So this is really just, like, it's not even the beginning. Mm-hmm. Like, if we were really talking about, we haven't even started.
Yeah, it's just the TBS word.
But it gives me a lot of hope. Like, I think what Time's Up is doing is the right place to put your energy in a way. Mm-hmm. Like, creating a legal defense fund that other people in other industries can tap into, and just having a place to go.
Yeah.
Even if you're not, if you're in the acting industry, if you're not in the acting industry, to say, like, I need help with this. What do I do next? Like, people need a plan.
Yeah.
You need to have some structure around what's happening to you to make sense of it in a way, mm-hmm. and to give yourself, need action items. It's hard to figure out what your action items would be.
Yeah. Well, Samantha Bee, Full Frontal, is in its third season now.
That's so crazy. I feel like we both just started, and we've been on the air for 300 years.
did you always, I mean, going back to how you got into this, did you always know, I mean, you're Canadian,
mm-hmm.
and American,
yes.
now? That's a whole other question. Like, yeah. Why would you choose to leave Canada? We're all trying to get in. I mean, you have, like,
house, you could live with them for a little while. So, like, try it on for size. Oh!
Yeah, yeah. I lived there for about 6 months. And I love Toronto. Like,
it's,
I think it's like a great city.
It
so
is great.
Why not just stay there?
Well,
and,
I'll tell you.
I mean, we're very glad to have you here,
thank
by
you.
The way. Don't want you to go, but why America and why not Canada?
Well, I, to be perfectly honest with you, Canada didn't see much potential. I mean, I worked in Canada, I certainly did, but I didn't work a lot. I was, when I got the job at The Daily Show, I was really on the verge of quitting the industry entirely. So that was kind of like my last, I felt that was my last audition, actually.
Wow.
Because I just didn't feel, I just couldn't be bothered with it anymore. It was just like disappointment after disappointment after disappointment. And so I thought, at the time when that audition emerged for me, I was like, this is it. Okay, great. I'll do the best audition of my life, and then I can leave this industry with a clean conscience.
Uh-huh.
Like, that I did my absolute best, mm-hmm. and I'm done with it. And then it just changed, and then the direction of my life obviously completely changed. So America chose me, is what I'm saying. But I'm grateful. And now I choose you. Now I choose you. And then I chose America back. Like,
you're doing a great service. I will confess that there have been moments where I've called my Canadian friends, mm-hmm. and I've said, okay, get me a really good immigration lawyer. I can't stand it anymore.
Right.
And then when I really think about it, I think I want to be here. I want to do better. I love my country. And I want it to be a country that I'm proud of. And
I love,
you know,
it here.
Yeah.
I have my American citizenship. I vote now. My children are born here.
Yeah.
I love it here, and I want to stay here, and I'm invested in this place, and I believe in it, actually, also. And I know that we can do better, and I know that we will do better, and I know that it will be fine eventually.
Do you feel like it will be fine?
Yes, I do, Molly Ringwald.
Can you reassure us?
I don't know how long he will be the president of this country. He'll, I'm sure, change the laws at some point.
From
so
your voice to Morgan Freeman's ears.
Oh no! I believe in the you know, this country is not the administration. There's amazing people, right?
I think so. I remember being a little girl and in the car with my family and seeing impeach Nixon bumper stickers as a little girl and saying, and I thought it had something to do with peaches. And I remember asking my parents, like, what does that mean? And, and they said, oh, he's a horrible man. And, you know, we're trying to get him not to be our president. And I feel like it must have been like Watergate. It must have been that feeling of this can't be happening in our country. This can't be happening. At some point, justice has to prevail and something has to be done.
We do have to get people to vote more.
Yes.
And I'm not sure how to do that. We do have to get those people who previously did not vote. We have to get them interested in voting, just like a smallish number of them, even just like a minimal number of those people who aren't that interested in voting. If they could just vote this time, that would be great. And also people who've never voted before. First-time voters would be, I think, the key to everything, really.
What do you say to people? Because I have met some of the younger generation who feel that they're making a stand by not voting, and which enrages me, but I feel like, you know, venting on these people doesn't do any good. So what do you say to people who are not, who feel like they're making that kind of a stand?
Well, I would hope, I mean, and I, this is only a hope, I would hope that they could look around and see what the consequences of not engaging with the political system are, because they do have real world consequences in people's lives. And also we're creating a game that will incentivize people to vote, so we're hoping that people will just start voting to win a prize.
Tell us
barring everything else notwithstanding, and apathy abounds, but what if you could get a free burrito? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's a little experiment that we're doing.
Have you done it yet? Or
no, we're launching a game in the summer and into the fall to try to incentivize people to vote. Mm-hmm. It's a huge experiment. Like, we don't know. I mean, who knows? But it's been a really crazy, fun project. Like, I know nothing about Silicon Valley and their processes, so it's been a real journey of discovery. Mm-hmm. It's an enormous undertaking to build an app, which I did not really understand when I thought this would be like a fun thing that we did. And then we'll see how it goes. I mean, maybe people will vote if you give them stuff. Maybe tube socks are the answer to all of our nation's ills.
You would hope that people realize that their vote matters, but you know, I think it's the Electoral College that people say, oh, well, my vote doesn't matter. Well, New York is already liberal. Oh, well, that, you know, and it's, you know, I mean, I know people that, I know young folk that have that point of view, and it's, I find it maddening.
It is maddening. Like, sometimes you just have to do the thing. You have to, like, hold your nose and do your civic duty.
Yeah.
Because nobody will be perfection for you. We are not in the business of churning out candidates who are perfect in every single way. Like, seeking total purity in a person is not necessarily the most fruitful.
Yeah. Well, we do have some clips from your show. I've been trying to figure out an organic way to introduce this clip.
Something like clip time. Clip number one and go.
Well, this clip is your advice.
Got it.
Your advice for men.
Okay.
It's called
Everybody
Penis
and the
PSA.
Okay.
Penis PSA. Hey, everyone. With all these big sexual harassment cases going public, men are getting concerned about how they can avoid being accused. Some have even stopped having solo meetings with women at all, which is great for women's careers. Thanks, guys. So, I have some business advice. Fellas, I'm a big comedy star slash Hollywood executive, and I found that it's quite easy not to masturbate in front of my employees. It's one of the easiest things I don't do. Every day I wake up, get dressed, take the subway to work, and then don't masturbate in front of anyone. Next time you get the urge to masturbate, just ask yourself, am I in front of an employee or a colleague? And if the answer is yes, don't. Just don't. And also, while I have you here, men, I'm sorry to break this to you, but your dick is ugly. No one wants to see your dick in any context. Even the straightest, horniest woman who loves you the most is hoping you can get it inside her without her having to look at it. So definitely don't show it to strangers. Don't text pics of it to people, and don't whip it out at film festivals. Your dick is objectively the worst thing about you.